Well, good morning, Harvest. How are we doing today? Great. I'm so glad to be here. I have the wonderful privilege of getting to share with you guys. It's my prayer that as I talk through this, that y'all are impacted as much as I was this week as I was reading through it. Before we jump in, let me introduce myself again. My name is Conley McCabe, and I am the student pastor here at Crystal Lake. So if you are a student or you have students and they're not yet involved with us, I'd love to connect with you after service and see if there's any way we could partner together. Another important thing you need to know about me is that I'm married to the most amazing woman in the whole world. She's so amazing that right now she's currently serving in our kids ministry. I can talk about her and she won't be embarrassed, so it's great. Today we're finishing up our series in Elijah, and this wild prophet to the country of Israel. Last week we learned about Elijah right after his victory at Mount Carmel, when he was at his lowest, when he just wanted nothing but just to die. And it's a low point in his life, but I really enjoy this story because it shows us the spiritual power of a nap and a snack. And it was great that there's, you know, biblical evidence to support that. But today we're gonna be jumping ahead in the story a bit. We won't be in 1 Kings 19 where we left off, but instead we're gonna be in 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 14. A lot has happened to Elijah since this moment. Our main antagonist, King Ahab, remember he's married to Jezebel. This guy, he repents of his sin, and some time goes on and he actually dies. And now his son, Ahaziah, has taken his place. And he is following in his dad's footsteps. He's a bad guy, and he ends up actually falling through a roof and getting really hurt. And there's this whole altercation between him and Elijah. He does not repent. And he dies as well. But most importantly, what happens is that Elijah takes on a disciple named Elisha. And Elisha is introduced in chapter 19. He's a farmer like most of the people back in that time. And Elijah just comes up to him, walks up to him, takes his cloak, and puts it on Elisha's shoulders. Like, you know, come and follow me. You know, you're going to be my disciple now. And Elisha immediately, in the middle of his, I guess, work day, gets up, takes all the oxen he has, and slaughters them, and cooks them up and gives them to his family and to his neighbors. And he's basically saying, like, I'm not going back to this. I'm all in with you, Elijah. And so he's all in with Elijah. They've been going together for a while, but now Elijah is going to be called to be with the Lord. And he's going to show us what it looks like to finish well. So if you're taking notes this morning, the title of my sermon is Faithful to the End. Faithful to the End. Commitment and faithfulness are hard to come by these days. I know that in the past, companies would honor your faithfulness to them. Like if you stayed there for an extended period of time, you get pension, you get more days off, that kind of thing. That's not so much the case now. People are jumping from job to job. Similarly, in relationships, we see that there isn't as much value placed in long-term commitment to one person. And it seems like it's a lot easier to quit. Now, I can't diagnose this problem. I don't necessarily know why there's these cultural shifts happening. But I can thankfully say that God is not like us in this way, where we are non-committal. He is all in. Where we are faithless against him, he's continually faithful towards us. And while this has been the story of humanity all throughout history, human beings being unfaithful to God, we today can make a choice to love and serve God with everything we have. And so that's what this message today is about. We have Elijah at the end of his life, Elisha at the beginning of his ministry. And in it, we can learn how to lead faithful lives to our Creator. So there are three things that these men exhibited that made them faithful to the end. And the first thing that we see is that they are steadfastly resolved. Steadfastly resolved. So if you have your Bibles, turn to 2 Kings chapter 2. We're going to be hopping in verses 1 through 7. Now when the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven by a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. And Elijah said to Elisha, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me as far as Bethel." But Elisha said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. And the sons of the prophets who were in Bethel came out to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he said, "Yes, I know. Keep quiet." And Elijah said to him, "Elisha, please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to Jericho." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So they came to Jericho. The sons of the prophets who were at Jericho drew near to Elisha and said to him, "Do you know that today the Lord will take away your master from over you?" And he answered, "Yes, I know it. Keep quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Please stay here, for the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." But he said, "As the Lord lives and as you yourself live, I will not leave you." So the two of them went on. So we see lots of repetition here, of course. And we see that somehow people know that Elijah is going to be taken up. Maybe there was a memo that I didn't get, but Elijah is going to be taken up to heaven, and everyone seems to know it. It's common knowledge. And on that day, Elijah and his disciple Elisha, it's confusing, are traveling from Gilgal, and Elijah turns to his disciple, and he says, "Stay here," but Elisha refuses him. And then they go on to Bethel, right? Presumably to hear Bethel's latest album or something. But when they get there, there's these local prophets come out and are asking him, like, isn't today the day where Elijah's gonna be taken from you? And Elisha's like, "Yeah, I know, shut up." And I think it's kind of funny, because have you ever been in a situation like this where there's something nerve-wracking about to happen? Like maybe you're about to preach, or maybe you have a presentation or some kind of promotion coming up, and everyone's like, "Man, how's it going?" And you're like, "I'm really nervous. Please just be quiet about it." And but that's what's happening here. This crazy thing's about to happen in his life, and people keep on asking him about it. And then also Elijah, his mentor, is telling him to stay there, but he's like, "No, I'm not gonna leave you." So they go on to Jericho, and what do you know? More people are asking him. He's like, "Yeah, I know, be quiet." And he tells Elijah, he's like, basically, like, "I'm with you to the end of the line," and they finally get to the Jordan River. So in this story, we see the steadfast determination from both Elijah and Elisha. Elijah, because he knows this is his last day on earth, but he doesn't necessarily know the manner in which it's gonna happen. He knows something is gonna happen, but it's gotta be nerve-wracking. Like the whole day he's kind of like looking at his watch, like, is it now? Is it happening? Is it later? Okay, later, cool. And particularly for me, I think this would be very hard. It would be hard to keep going. I'd just be like, "Just let it happen. Just do it, just take me now." Like Kelsey sometimes will take me on surprise dates where I don't know where I'm going or what we're gonna be eating or doing. And the whole time I'm like, "Man, this is so fun. But you could just tell me. Just go ahead and just get it all over with and just tell me what's happening next. Like, no, really, where are we going? I need to know." And I can't stand the anticipation. So that's me like on a surprise date, let alone the day that I'm gonna be taken to be with the Lord. So Elijah, he's resolved, and so is Elisha. And particularly, this isn't Elisha's lot, right? Like, he doesn't have to be there. He just loves and cares for his mentor so much that he wants to be with him. He's like, "Wherever you go, I go." A few years ago, a movie came out called Hachi. I don't know if you guys saw this. You might have seen it, but it's based on a true story about a dog from Japan called Hachiko. And Hachi became like a Japanese hero because of his faithfulness to his master. And the story goes basically that this guy, Ueno, he wanted a certain breed of dog. He wanted a puppy called Nikita. And These dogs are known for their loyalty, for being so obedient, for being forming really strong bonds with like a small group of people. And so this guy, he gets this puppy and he trains him and they're best buds. And then what happens is he starts to take the dog with him to the train every day. So the dog will walk with him to the train and then wait there until 3 p.m. And then the guy would come off the 3 p.m. train and then they'd walk home together. And so what happened is they did this for a while, right, for a couple years. And then one day, Ueno goes, but he never comes back. And what had happened is that while Ueno was at work, he had a brain hemorrhage, and he ended up passing away from it. And Hachi was left waiting there at the train station, and he waited for hours, for days, for ends up waiting years. He gets taken care of by some neighbors of the man. But every day at 3 p.m., he's back at the train station waiting for his master to return. And, I mean, I wish my dogs were like that. I always had golden retrievers, and they just go to whoever gave them attention. But the crazy thing is that Hachiko might actually have more commitment and resolve to his master than we do to ours. Like, in the good times, we can lift our hands up and worship God. We can put our trust in him, but what happens to our resolve when God doesn't show up in the way that we want him to? When we get that bad diagnosis, or when we're in a toxic work environment, or when we don't know where our future is headed, do we stay faithful or do we leave him behind? Often during hardships, we feel that God has abandoned us. We cry out to God to take us out of the pain, out of the discomfort. But is it possible that this is right where God wants you to be? Maybe like Elisha, these aren't just negative circumstances, but they're also tests of your faith. See, the things that Elijah was being put through was so that he could receive the reward at the end. This wasn't just for nothing, but these were tests that Elijah was making sure that he was really willing to take up his spot after he left. He had to be sure that he was willing to follow him. There was no half in, no half out. And it should make us wonder, am I following God like that? Is my commitment that strong? Or am I following God because it's easy? Or am I here because I want that ticket to the pearly gates? But God should be our ultimate goal above all else. If every material blessing was removed from your life, like Job, would he be enough? Are we committed to God or to ourselves? Okay, let's keep going. So the first thing they had was steadfast resolve. Now the second thing that they demonstrated was spiritual hunger. They were both spiritually hungry. So let's read verses 8 to 12 and see what I mean. Then Elijah took his cloak and rolled it up and struck the water, and the water was parted to the one side and to the other, so the two of them could go over on dry ground. When they crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Ask what I shall do for you before I am taken from you." And Elisha said, "Please let there be a double portion of your spirit on me." And he said, "You have asked a hard thing. Yet, if you see me as I am being taken from you, it shall be so for you. But if you do not see me, it shall not be so." And as they still went on and talked, behold, chariots of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them. And Elijah went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it, and he cried, my father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen." And he saw him no more. So what's happening here, right? Elisha passes the tests. Every single time that Elijah tries to turn him away, he pushes ahead. And now they come to the Jordan River. And Elijah, he rolls up his cloak. So we got here, this is a cloak. And he slaps the water, right? And then what happens is the water parts. And he's reenacting that miracle that Moses performed at the Sea of Reeds. And so he's putting him up there, right, with the top gun of the Torah. And so he slaps it, and it parts. And they get across, and Elijah asks his disciple, "What is the thing you want? If it's within my power, I'll give it to you." If someone asks this of you, like, "Ask anything of me," if Elon Musk came up to you and he was like, "Anything you ask, I shall give you," and what would you ask for? I mean, first thing in my mind was like money. Money, maybe it could be a new car. Cars are really expensive right now. Maybe better health, maybe fame. It could be anything, but I bet that we wouldn't be asking for the same thing that Elisha asks for. And what is he asking for here? He says a double portion of his spirit. He wants more of God. Before I keep going, let me point something out I learned this week. When it says double portion, that isn't like when you go to Chipotle and ask for more steak. That's different, okay? I thought the same thing, but apparently back in those days, the eldest son, whenever the parents were passing away, the eldest son would receive twice the inheritance as everyone else. Because he's in charge of caring for the family, of looking after everything, right? So for example, I'm one of four kids, and whenever, you'd think nowadays that whenever my parents pass away, they'll divide the inheritance evenly amongst us four. That's not the case back then. Because the eldest son had the responsibility to look after everyone, what they did was divide everything they had into five. So if there's four of us, they'd divide it into five, and they'd give two portions to the eldest son. I mean, honestly, you know, my older brother, Drew, he would get two shares, and that's fine with me. Me and my sisters were kind of a lot of work, so he would need that extra money to look after us. But when Elisha asks for this, he is saying that I want to be your son, and I want to carry on your legacy. I saw how God used you. There's something special about your relationship with God, and I want that. I've had a few of people in my life where I see them, I'm like, man, the Lord is with them, and I want to be just like them. And it's not because they can preach really well, or they're super eloquent, or they have the best prayers, but they're the people who I've seen go through such crazy hardship, and they come out, and the whole time their hands are raised, you know? Those people who just stand so strong and are so spiritually hungry for the Lord in the hardest times. And so when Elisha says, I want to be the next you, he's basically saying the same thing. That's a bold ask, right? Because we've just been learning about how crazy Elijah's life was. It wasn't all glamorous where there's definitely highlights, right? Like telling the king off and making like poop jokes about other gods and revealing himself to him. But just as crazy as how often people were trying to kill him, how often he had to hide in caves, subsist on food delivered by raven eats, and how often he felt at the end of his wits and he just wanted to die. Most of us, if given the chance to ask for anything, would not ask for that. But that's what Elisha does. He had a hunger to see his people loving and serving the Lord no matter what it cost him personally. Maybe you're like me and your initial reaction was not the same as Elisha's. So the question is, how can we cultivate that same spiritual hunger that Elisha has? When I have questions about the Bible, I think a good rule of thumb is to see, like, what does Jesus say about this? So that's what we did. And in Matthew 19, Jesus, he tells a crowd of people to not store up treasures on earth where moth and vermin destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But he says instead, store up treasures in heaven where moth and vermin don't destroy, where thieves do not break in and steal. For this is the important part, where your treasure is, that your heart will be also. When we think about it, we would think it would be the other way around, right? Like the things that I think are important, I put my treasure into, but it's the opposite. He says, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. So we got to invest into something to treasure it. Fantasy football, I think, is a good example. When I'm playing fantasy football, I'm all in. I'm watching every single game, doesn't matter who's playing, even if I don't care about the teams because I have someone on that team, right? And I need to make sure that I watch because if I don't watch, then my players aren't going to do as good. And I gotta make sure I'm doing everything I can to be involved so I can be top dog and I can get that money at the end of the thing. But if I'm not in a league, then I might just watch the highlights, you know, maybe, of the Cowboys. So how do we cultivate a hunger like that? We put some skin in the game. Maybe something for us, like if we want a spiritual hunger like Elijah, maybe we commit to serving in Harvest Kids for a year, or maybe we finally get around to starting that D group, or you commit every morning at a certain time, say, I'm gonna pray for the people in my life that don't know God to come to know him. It could be anything, but begin investing into the kingdom of God regularly and see what happens. I bet that it'll turn from a chore into something that you truly cherish. So they were steadfastly resolved, spiritually hungry, and finally, securely confident. Securely confident. All right, let's hop back in verses 10 through 14. And he said, you have asked a hard thing, yet if you see me as I am being taken from you, it shall be so. But if you do not see me, it shall not be so. And as they still went on and talked, behold, chariots of fire and horses of fire separated the two of them, and Elisha went up by a whirlwind into heaven. And Elisha saw it, and he cried, my father, the chariots of Israel and its horsemen, and he saw him no more. Then he took hold of his own clothes, and he tore them in two pieces. And he took up the cloak of Elijah that had fallen from him, went back, and stood on the bank of the Jordan. Then he took the cloak of Elijah that had fallen from him and struck the water, saying, where is the Lord, the God of Elijah? And when he had struck the water was parted to one side and to the other, and Elisha went over. So Elisha had his bold ask, right? He said, give me the double portion. And Elijah says, if you see me taken up, then it's all yours. And they continue walking. They see their chariots of fire separate them. And Elijah is taken into heaven by a whirlwind. Elijah's taken into heaven. He doesn't die, right? And this can be confusing, I think, because we're like, okay, wait, then was Elijah like the best? Not necessarily. I don't think this was because Elijah was perfect or he never sinned, but I think that this serves as a foreshadowing to Jesus. One of the best practices for understanding confusing parts of scripture is to read Christologically or with Christ like in mind. And when we do that, it makes more sense of what happens to Elijah because it's foreshadowing what's gonna happen with Jesus when he ascends to be with the Lord. And that's why Moses and Elijah are two of the guys that visit Jesus when he's transfigured. God was showing part of the reason that Moses and Elijah lived and did what they did was to point to his son, both negative and positive ways. Through their good actions and their bad, we see Jesus or we see a need for him. Okay, back to the story. So Elisha sees this amazing and terrible thing. He's grieved. He's going to miss his adopted father figure, and he tears his clothes in grief. And as he looks around, I don't know, I like to think like in a movie, you know, if I were to shoot a movie about this scene, Elijah's taken up, and then like the mantle like floats down. And Elijah takes it, picks it up, and okay, yeah, sorry, I've been saying cloak and mantle interchangeably. It's like the same thing. It was like the, you've seen like Jewish people will have this thing around their head. It's called a tallit. That's what they think that might have been. And so he takes this up, and he looks around, he sees the mantle, and he verbalizes the question that everyone's thinking, right? Is Yahweh with Elisha the same way he was with Elijah? And as an answer, he rolls it up. I don't know, I'm taking so much care with this thing. He smacks the water with the mantle, and boom. Jordan, second time that day, split in two so he can walk on dry ground. The fish had to be like so confused. Second time that day, they were like, what is going on? This used to be a good neighborhood. And he walks through, and the group of 50 prophets recognize that God is with him too. Why do I say that this is a confident move? Well, imagine, this shouldn't be hard, that you're a son or daughter of a circus performer. Okay, we're all there. And your father bequeaths to you his prized unicycle. Now, you've never gotten to ride it because this was his prized possession, right? And he protected it at all costs. But now you're 12 years old and he thinks you're old enough to give it a go. But your first attempt isn't just gonna be you two in the driveway. No, you're gonna do it prime time in the big top on the tightrope with no net, all right? Scary stuff. And at the very least, that's how Elisha would have felt when he picked up that mantle. Because if it were me, I would have gone in like a place where no one was watching and like tried to slap the Jordan. But Elisha does it like immediately in front of these people. And where does that confidence come from? I think he's confident because he just spent the whole day going from holy site to holy site, being reminded of God's faithfulness. When I first read this, I just glossed over the names of the places, but as I studied, it was so cool to see their significance. And I encourage y'all to do the same thing later on, but when they start off at a place called Gilgal, and Gilgal is first seen in Joshua 4. This is a place where Joshua and all the Israelites, they cross the Jordan, and because they crossed on dry ground, just like this, they pick up some stones and they erect like a statue to remind them of how God moved in that way. That's gotta be encouraging if you're gonna be attempting to do the same thing later that day. And not only did they go to Gilgal, but they went to Bethel, the house of God. And this is where Jacob has a heavenly vision where he sees angels going up and down this stairway or ladder and into heaven. And above it, Yahweh says this. This is so cool. He says, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and to your offspring. Your offspring shall be like the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and to the east and to the north and to the south. And in you and your offspring shall all the families of the earth be blessed. Behold, I am with you and will keep you wherever you go and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. So when they go to Bethel, he's gonna have that image, those words in his mind as he's visiting that place. He's reminded of God's covenant to the people of Israel. Men will fail you, he might have thought, but God never will. And they made one stop before the Jordan River, and that was at Jericho. Jericho is the one from VeggieTales where the French peas throw the slushies on the Israelites from the top of the ramparts. Or more specifically, it's where Joshua and the Israelites marched around the city for 6 days, one time each day of the 6 days. And then on the seventh day, they marched around seven times. And finally, the walls fell and the Israelites won. Huge miracle, but it had to feel like ridiculous. God moving in a huge way, but sometimes it might feel silly to walk it out. And the people around us might think we're strange. We might look at us weird, but it'll all be worth it when the walls come tumbling down. So after Elisha was taken through this historical, spiritual experience, he's primed and reminded of the character of God and how he has shown up in the past. Elijah was doing with Elisha what I want to do with y'all right now. I want to remind you of God's goodness and his faithfulness. We can be confident in any circumstance that his will be done and that ultimately everything will be made right. So we should be able to walk into any situation and feel confident and secure knowing that the Lord is with us because God is good, y'all. He's faithful, he's merciful, he's kind, he's slow to anger, he is love, he is the Alpha and the Omega. And our circumstances only seem insurmountable when we have to handle them ourselves. If Elisha had tried to split the Jordan in his own strength, he would have been swept away by the current. He had to rely on Yahweh. And God wants us to have assurance and complete confidence in him that he is gonna work it out. It may not be how we like, but at least on this side of heaven, but we can hold tight to the promise that he will make it all right and that we will have every need met in him. So I'd like to invite the band up as I close. I think we're doing a final song. But you and I have received a miracle even bigger than the seas parting, bigger than the walls of Jericho falling down, bigger than a vision of heaven. We've received the miracle of salvation in Jesus. That we, like Israel, were lost in the wilderness of our sin. That we had no hope of ever crossing on our own. We can't reach God on our own strength, so he parted the waters of death and he brought us to him that we might have abundant life, flowing with milk and honey. That we'd be brought from death to life in him. When you're on the wrong side of the Jordan, you need a miracle. Remind yourself of God's faithfulness. His faithfulness to the Israelites, his faithfulness through Christ, and his faithfulness in your own personal life. Don't allow the burdens of this life to steal your commitment to God. Be someone who is called faithful to the end. Let's pray. Dear Lord, thank you so much for this day. Thank you so much for these stories that remind us of how good you are, Lord, to your creation, to the people whom you care for. Lord, we pray that today that we just be able to begin our journey of or recommit our faithfulness to you, God, whether it be in small ways or big ways. Lord, we pray that we take physical steps, God, to recreate that hunger for you. So, Lord, we pray that in your son's name. And everybody said, amen.